silver. We've been seeing lately where they've been throwing a huge amount of paper contracts at gold and also at silver. And over the last couple of weeks, they've been throwing more paper contracts at gold and silver. I mean, thousands of paper contracts, and they suppress the price, but the price isn't staying that low. It looks like they're having a little bit of trouble trying to keep the price low, and it keeps creeping back up. Why do you think right now they're throwing so many paper contracts at gold and silver, and why do you think they're trying to keep the price down?
Well, let me start with the last question. Why are they keeping a price down? Gold is a barometer of the financial health of the world or a nation state. And at this point, it's basically the world because it's a hegemony of the US dollar being the reserve currency. So if gold is, skyrocketing, everyone that's involved at a, financial level will take note. And even people that are kind of on the sidelines that really don't have much savings or whatever would note because it would be in the headlines. So price movement makes headline news. So they really have to kind of keep gold managed. I like that word better than manipulated, but I can use the word manipulation. And let me digress. I mean, just so people, I know there's new listeners all the time, and there's always, well, Morgan's this and that. I mean, like I gave them a Masonic handshake. I mean, all this nonsense, it's ludicrous that's out there. So for the record, there is a chapter in the Silver Manifesto, my second book, on silver manipulation. So I wrote a whole chapter on it. In fact, it's based on a lot of factual information you could use. You could probably use it in a court of law for whether or not silver is manipulated. So I come back to gold. So gold really has to be managed because if it takes off too fast, too far, for too long, it's going to upset the financial hierarchy. So that's the reason for reason. That's how I see it. That's the intent. Now, how it's done, of course, is by making sure that there's enough supply in the market to keep the price low. And the supply is not physical supply for the most part. Most of the supply is a derivative of some type, be it an exchange traded product, be it a futures contract, an options contract, a gold certificate, a deep storage gold, gold swap, gold loan, and on it goes. So there's a lot of paper product out there that acts as if it is supply that keeps the price managed, because if it was really a cash-only market and there was no hedging available, you would see a different gold price, and the same for silver. So the reason the open interest increases is because they need to create new supply out of thin air to keep the price managed.
We also see silver dropping here. And what's very interesting is that the silver demand is increasing, but the price of silver keeps dropping. Does this make any sense to you?
Well, that takes a bit of explanation, and I've got myself, I guess, in a position where I've got more interest in what I have to say here recently. I was at the Silver and Gold Summit conference in San Francisco, California, very recently, and I was interviewed by Kitco, and I talked about what my speech was about, which was actually technology breakthroughs in the mining industry, which was pretty well attended. And then, of course, at the end of this interview, which was, just a few minutes, Daniela asked me, I have to ask you about silver. What's the real story on the supply of silver? Is it, I hear it's building or it's shrinking. What is it? Something along those lines. I said, well, the fact is that the supply of silver above ground dwindled from 1990 to 2006, went from about 2 billion ounces to 0.5. And then from that point, 2006 to now, it's rebuilt by 2 billion ounces. So if you look at the World Silver Survey, the one the Silver Institute puts out, the one that's run by Thomson Reuters, you will see in their latest World Silver Survey that the amount of silver above ground is something like a 21-year high and a 30-month supply. And so when I said that, which is all factually based on both the GFMS study and the CPM study, they both pretty much agree on the numbers and, round numbers. And this got a lot of people upset. But really, I didn't get to tell the other half of the story. And just by the way, Dave, I put a video blog up that just got published, basically that's for speaking, really, on my blog at the morganreport.com. Just go to the blog, pull down the menu, and you know, click the link on the latest blog, and I do a video blog on this. But so the reason that you know, the silver price went higher and higher and higher as the supply was building and building and building is because the demand was so strong. That is what runs it. You know, let's just do a thought experiment real quick. Let's say that there's only one Gremlin automobile left, and it's like chartreuse, and no one wants to buy it. You know, so it's a one of a kind chartreuse Gremlin sitting on a used car lot in New Jersey. But everyone just looks at it and pokes fun at it, and no one wants to buy it. So that's a very limited supply, but the price is basically zero because no one wants it. On the other hand, silver from 2006 during this build had about a three to four-fold increase in investment demand. Ever since the financial crisis of 2008, the demand for precious metals, particularly silver, has been extraordinarily robust. Now, the somewhat bad news, Dave, in the last 6 months, maybe even a year, it has dropped off. It's not nearly as strong as it has been. We can tell that by coin sales, by the U.S. Mint. I talked to some of the major dealers, both on the wholesale side and on the retail side, and some dealers are doing well, and some are not. But on aggregate, the demand, it has waned in 2017. There's been some shift. You know, I hear these anecdotal stories, and some I absolutely believe because I know these people personally. I've known them for 10 or 20 years. Where, for an example, one of my Canadian friends that deals in silver and gold said that he had an individual that came with a pickup truck full of monster boxes of silver, traded them all for cash, went into Bitcoin and bought Bitcoin. And this was, you know, like the beginning of the year. And he said recently they came back after selling like one Bitcoin and filled their pickup truck again. So there has been some, I think more on the silver side, Dave, than on the gold side, moving out of precious metals, and particularly silver, into Bitcoin. I'm not saying it's the whole thing. It's just part of the story. How much of the story is it? I'm really not sure. But what I am sure of is that there is a sentiment in the precious metals that is at a very, very low point. In fact, it may be the lowest it's been since we've had this bear market within an ongoing bull. I still believe we're in an ultimate bull market for the precious metals. I actually looked at the gold chart again this morning before the interview, and as ugly as it looks, the major uptrend line that was there for 11 straight years, I mean, we got spoiled for 11 years, year over year, year over year, year over year, gold prices were higher and higher and higher and higher. And like Bitcoin, there were some that thought this could go on forever. You know, 11 years is a pretty good run. And then when it peaked out in September 2011, myself included, and not everyone, I don't speak for everyone else, but a lot of, you can look in history on the internet, a lot of folks thought, okay, you know, it's going to be a bear correction within a secular bull market. It'll be a couple of years. I thought it'd be two or three at the most. I didn't envision it go all the way through 2017, but that's where we are. But I absolutely believe that we've probably washed out everyone that we need to wash out for the base to build from here and go back up.
Now, it's very interesting that you said something about a cryptocurrency, because I think a lot of people are looking at cryptocurrency and saying, okay, look, the central bank or the banking system, and then we know the banking system, they were controlling the silver market, they control the gold market. There have been people that have been brought up on charges, and we know the central bank does control the gold and silver prices because, you know, they want to keep everything low and push everyone into the stock market, keep everyone in the dollar. They don't want everyone to realize that there's something wrong. Now, the crypto market, this is completely a different animal because the central banks, they don't have the ability to control the crypto market. They would love control, and it looks like they're trying to get into the crypto market by controlling it with future contracts, just like they did with gold and silver. And it looks like they're going to try to do this Will it work? We don't know. And we see that the central banks are very worried about this. But on the other hand, we see the BRICS. Now, remember, China and Russia, they've been accumulating a huge amount of gold. Now, the BRICS came out and they said they're going to be creating a gold trading system. And they commented, you know, on the COMEX, the London gold paper trading, the Swiss trading system. And they're saying that it's really not reliable and they want to establish a new benchmark. From what you're seeing and what you're hearing about this new BRICS trading system, which they want to bring online, I believe, in 2018, will this change the value of gold and silver the way it's priced going forward?
Well, Dave, you know me pretty well, and I'm pretty conservative. I like to, you know, be as correct like any human as much as possible. First of all, I know exactly the article you're referring to. I did it in my weekly perspective. I do every week kind of wrapping up the top financial news and always talk at the end about precious metals. I think eventually it will. I don't think right away it will. I think when it starts, it'll be looked at somewhat from a distance and probably not that much volume for a while. But I think as it's trusted more and more, and as I like to call seasoned, where it's been around for, you know, 4, 5, 6 months, and everyone's familiar with its functioning, and they see how the trades are made and what the availability is, and that the deliveries are on time, and this type of size that's, you know, taken off the exchange and all that. I think once that's established, then I think it could definitely start to impact these other markets. I mean, you know, if you look at the LME, you look at the COMEX, you look at everything that's going on and has been going on from basically the start of the futures markets. There's been control from, you know, the gold fix, the silver fix. Of course, those have been changed to electronic numbers, but basically the game is still played the same. It's just played electronically. So anyone that comes with a market that is actually available and trusted that can produce real results, I think is definitely a competitor that over time will make a mark. And it could, not would, but could have enough of an impact where you might see the price control coming out of that entity rather than out of the London, New York consortium.
Why do you think they're bringing this up now? Why do you think they're looking at this saying, okay, we need some other type of trading system to trade gold and silver? From, you know, from what you're looking at, why do you think they're doing this now?
Well, of course, that gets into intent, and, you know, that's kind of reading people's minds. I'll certainly comment on it, but this is pure speculation on my part. But I think it's probably because they have enough gold now. I mean, if you look at China, they do not export an ounce of gold. All of the gold mining that takes place in China stays in China. And then they just keep importing more and more and more gold all the time. Russia is pretty much the same way. So I think the East has a sufficient supply of physical where, you know, as Warren Buffett says, when you go out, you know, into the water and you get hit by the high tide and you know, lose your bathing suit, you come out, everyone sees what's really going on. That's a metaphor for what's really going on with gold or silver, because if it starts to get where the physical market commands the price, which it should, the derivative really shouldn't set the price, but of course it has for years and years and years, as we all know. If or when that takes place, that is when we're going to get a different story on gold and silver. And when would you start that? Well, logic tells me that you'd only do that if you had sufficient physical supply to meet the demand side. Now, that doesn't mean that they're going to be selling their own physical supply. What it means is they have enough of their own, and they're going to probably, in my view, put pressure on these other purported stockpiles that may be resting in London, New York, Chicago, and some of the warehouses that are not only COMEX approved, but other warehouses around the world that, you know, warehouse gold. So I think, again, that this certainly has the potential to change the game. And of course, it goes right back to what everyone probably over talks about, but I'll put in my 2 cents anyway. And that's, of course, the Economist cover from, I think, 1988 with the eagle standing on the burning currencies. with a 10 Phoenix medallion on it, 2018. And of course, the Tyleries get ready for a world currency. So a lot to think about. I do think that 2018 is a pivotal year, not just because of what the economist says, but just because of my work and many others that shows cyclically we're about due. Sentiment is so low. The loss of interest in probably one of the most valuable commodities out there, and that's silver. And I'm not saying it from a monetary aspect. I'm saying it from an industrial perspective. I mean, you cannot have the high technological world that we have today without silver. There's no way, shape, or form you could do it. It's in everything that's electrical or electronic. Even if it's a minuscule amount, it's an absolute imperative to have it.
I just want to say one other thing about what the countries of China and Russia are doing. If you really think about it, over the many years, they purchased this gold at, you know, prices like $1,100 an ounce, $1,200 an ounce. And if they establish a new benchmark and all of it is revalued to even $1,800 or $1,900 or $2,000 per ounce, depending on what currency you're using, I mean, already they've made out. I mean, because...
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. Yeah, absolutely. No, your thinking is very clear. I listened to the X22 report very often. I don't miss too many of your programs. And that's right. I mean, they have built a base at a good price. And the way you control a price to your liking is called accumulation or distribution. And this is basic market, not even theory, basic markets, how they actually function. And most people that are not, let's say seasoned traders or investors don't really understand this when they're just beginning. But let's use Bitcoin for an example. I mean, if Bitcoin hits, pick a number, let's say 15,000, everyone that's holding Bitcoin makes the assumption that their account is, you know, 15,000 times however many Bitcoin they have. But that's not true. I mean, at that moment in time, it appears to be true. But what's wrong about that is that that all markets move at the margin. So if someone bought half a Bitcoin and paid $7,500, it'll print as a $15,000 print. But let's just say that's one person and that's the high, for an example. So now the next bid comes in and someone wants to sell it at a higher price, but there's an offer, but there's no one taking it. So what happens is these markets move based on the amount of demand that is at any given time at any given price. So hopefully I said that sufficiently. So let's say that someone bought Bitcoin at 1,000 and the market starts to turn around and drop like we've seen Bitcoin do to the next place where someone's absolutely willing to purchase it. And let's say that is in the system at 10,000. So you could get this big drop from 15 to 10,000 because there's only one person out there willing to buy a quarter of a Bitcoin for that price. Now, that's an extreme example, but this is a very definite example exactly how markets work. So let's take the reverse. The reverse is you look at your favorite, let's say gold stock, and you see the 52-week high low, and you see the low on this, let's say it's a penny stock. Let's say the low was 80 cents. And you see that. Well, you might think, oh, my goodness, you know, I could have bought this stock. I could have loaded the boat on this stock at 80 cents. And now the stock is at $8. God, I should have done that. Not true, because there was only so much offered at the 80 cent price, maybe 2,000 shares. And once those 2,000 shares were gobbled up at 80 cents, the next offer was at 85 cents. For 5,000 shares. And once those were gobbled up, the next offer was at 90 cents for 25,000 shares. And this is how markets actually work. But most people look at the market capitalization and think, I'm rich. And not saying that you can't value approximately what your holdings are worth. But listen, I've been in this market, Davis, you know, a long time. Especially on the commodity side, more so on the equity side, but the principle applies to both. You want to sell in the strength. You do not want to sell after the top is in, especially on something volatile and leveraged like a commodity. So, you know, that's part of what I teach, part of what I do. But I want to make it clear that, you know, there's a lot of misunderstandings about basic market mechanics that people don't get. And the thing that concerns me somewhat about the Bitcoin world is, yeah, people have never traded a stock. never done anything, and you know, they just keep making, you know, money, 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 and that's good for them. I'm not, you know, that's fine, but they've never seen a real bear correction, and they don't understand how markets actually work as I just described. So they wouldn't know really that, you know, Bitcoin could go to 22,580 and then drop to 11,000 and stay at 11,000 for, you know, a matter of months. Now, I'm not predicting that at all. What I'm trying to convey is that all markets go up and down. Bitcoin has yet to have a bear phase to this market. I've never seen a market that continues to grow to the moon. I don't think Bitcoin will. I think if you look at silver versus Bitcoin, I can make this statement. There's a pretty good likelihood that Bitcoin will probably double in 2018, but it's been up about sevenfold this year. And it's more likely that silver would go up sevenfold over the next few years than Bitcoin would go up another sevenfold. That's what I'm trying to say. So, you know, if you're Bitcoin rich, you might consider buying an asset that's undervalued. Remember, I'm not a coin dealer. I'm not pushing them. No, David is, you know, I do not sell bullion. I do not sell coins. I sell intellectual information. We talk about the resource sector in general. In fact, one of our best picks is making a new high, and it's a zinc stock with good silver credits to it. But, you know, we saw the zinc shortage. So I digress to come back, Dave. Ask me another one, please.
Yeah, let's move on to the economy right now. And, you know, since Trump came into office, the stock market's going up. We see unemployment dropping. And we see that the corporate media and everyone else out there is saying that, you know, everything is great and everything is fine. When you look at the economy, what are you seeing? Are you seeing that the economy is doing fantastic, or do you see something completely different?
Well, I see something completely different. And, you know, a lot of what I see is just, you know, traveling around and listening to shows like yours. I mean, I never heard the term channel stuffing until I listened to the X22 report, but you know, channel stuffing exists everywhere. Every major city I go in, and even my local town here, you know, there's a huge, I mean, you cannot stuff another automobile on these car lots on any of the dealers. I'm not talking just the Chevy dealer or the Dodge dealer or the Ford dealer or the Nissan dealer or the Toyota dealer, all of them. And you also look around, and you don't see these, you know, 2017s rolling all over the place. They just don't exist. Now, I'm not saying I've been in every country, and maybe it's different in New York, but what I have seen, and I've seen plenty, that's one. The other is the collapse of retail. It's unbelievable how much retail has basically thrown in the towel and closed shop, or partially closed shop. In other words, closing down several of their stores in their chain, probably never to reopen again. Now people say, well, it's Amazon, it's online buying. Online buying is not nearly the percentage relative to the amount of brick and mortars that have closed. In other words, it's a mismatch. It does not hold water on that argument. Yes, online purchases have increased, but again, not nearly as significantly as the amount of brick and mortar that basically closed shop. So I've said this often, and I think it really needs to be repeated, and people need to bear it in mind. There is no relationship at this point in time, none whatsoever at all, that is between the financial markets and the physical economy. At one time, the stock market used to be a pretty good reflection of the health of the physical economy. That hasn't held true for a very, very long time. So the talking heads on the financial channels point and, you know, gasp and show you the numbers, and oh, and then they get their analysts on, you know, well, you know, on this basis, we really feel that the stock market certainly could go higher. Yes, if we look at that, you know, and they just come up with this gobbledygook nonsense, and they don't even look out the door to see what the physical economy is doing. Look at food prices. I mean, food is something that's needed. It's not a want, it's a need. And, you know, food prices continue to creep up and up and up and up. So I'm very disturbed about the inaccuracy of reporting between what the mainstream financial press states about the economy, or I'll say the physical economy, or implies physical economy, when they say, as you've said on your report, you know, everything's fine, wonderful, and, you know, look here, look there. And it's just not true. And then you look at the job situation. I mean, look at the labor participation rate. It's pathetic, pathetic. I mean, there's a lot of people out there that are working like two jobs that are paying maybe somewhat above minimum wage, or maybe, you know, a wage that's, let's say, one half of what they used to make when they were employed by, let's say, a major corporation. They lost their job. So now they have to take two jobs at half the pay to make the same wage that they were making before. And that's not a one-off or once in a while situation. That's pretty much across the board. So if you factor in going ahead and looking at what's going on in the robotics world with the machine language that's taking place, and like if you look at an Amazon factory, for an example, and you see all these robots running around, or even a modern automobile manufacturer, what you find is you've got this thing automated to the point where there's a lot less human employment available. It's all done by machines. And that trend is accelerating, not decelerating. So we really need to rethink, you know, what the educational system needs to teach for people to be, you know, happily employed or have a job that's worthwhile. And the other fact is that things are changing so fast, most people in the workforce must be prepared to change careers like 3, 4, or 5 times during their lifetime, because that's the way that things are moving. They're moving very rapidly. You have to be able to adapt. You have to be a lifelong learner. You have to be able to re-educate yourself. You have to admit when things are changing and make a move. This is a reality that we're in. And this talk about, you know, a guaranteed stipend that everyone gets that can't find a job, I mean, this is something that's been talked about, oh, in the annals of us economist types for quite some time, but never did I think back, you know, 20 years ago that that would be the reality. But I miscalculated how fast things were moving on the technology side. So this technocracy is an idea that basically, you know, machines know more than we do. We're going to hit the singularity. Everything's going to be great because computers are going to know us how to live our lives. All we have to do is be surveyed 24/7, 100% of the time, everything we think, do, and say. And life will be great because the computer knows what we want, what we need, and what we should be doing. I mean, this is really getting scary from my perspective.
Yeah, it is. I mean, you can see just with the phone, with the advertisements and everything like that, everywhere you go, if you look at something on Amazon or some, you know, it doesn't matter where you look, all of a sudden that same product shows up almost every single place, everywhere you go. And it seems like they're trying to, you know, have these algorithms learn what you're looking for, what you want. And now, of course, you know, they have Alexa, they have all these different things that you can speak to in your house, and, you know, they're always listening in. And that is a very scary thing when you think about it. I just wanted to turn towards the Fed right now, because we know that Janet Yellen said, you know, we're not going to see a crisis anytime in our lifetime. She also came out where she said that everything is contained. She used the C word, and Ben Bernanke, well, he also used the C word, contained, in 2008 when the market crashed in 2008. And we're getting a lot of warnings from the biz, the IMF, saying that this debt is completely unsustainable. And for the first time ever in history, the federal government debt has overtaken the consumer debt. I mean, are these warnings that they continually come out with, are they trying to tell us that we're headed into a, like, a disaster zone here?
Yeah, I think they are signaling that. I mean, the containment is a, you know, word where, you know, everyone knows it speaks English, that, you know, it's like roping off or putting a fence around something. And in that context, it's kind of like a temporary restraint. In other words, things are getting out of hand, but we've contained it, like, you know, traffic blockade or something. That's the reference, the way I see it. And, you know, to add on to that a bit, Dave, I mean, if you look at Japan, I mean, they're like, their debt's at like 250 times GDP. I mean, if you would ask me, could any modern country, we're not talking about Zimbabwe, but something of the clout of Japan's economy, could sustain a 250% debt to GDP level and be viable and people buy their paper, I would have said, are you kidding? Absolutely not. Well, I'm wrong. I mean, that's where we are right now. But it won't go on forever. I was, as I said, at the Silver and Gold Summit in San Francisco very recently, and there was a panel of us. It was Doug Casey, Rick Rule, myself, and a couple more. And the question was asked about, you know, kind of how does this end? And both Rick and Doug said that the moral way to do it is to admit that the debt can't be paid back, to own that fact, and to make an adjustment. In other words, and then go on, really, it said it won't be paid back. That's the moral thing to do. That was basically their statement. So I'm adding on this part that it could be adjusted some way, shape, or form. It could delay the time. You could say 50 cents on a dollar or whatever. That's what I'm saying. They both stated that it will just, the Federal Reserve and other central banks on the world will just keep printing. So it'll be the euro will keep printing, the yen will keep printing, the U.S. dollar will keep printing. And what no one talked about, and they all know it, was that, you know, at some point, the markets basically take notice and say they're never going to make good on what they owe us, and their currency is being printed to infinity. I don't trust their currency anymore. And that's part of, I think, the Bitcoin phenomena, is that some of the people that are in that space realize that there is a point of no return. And that's the worst thing for an economy, is for a currency to collapse, to take place, because that means that you can't trust the currency. However, the powers that be certainly know that and probably prepared for it in probably a number of ways. I mean, they probably have the SDR waiting in the wings, or some type of Fed, you know, crypto coin or whatever, or some of these corporations like Walmart, for example, will come up with their own, you know, wall coin or whatever. So there's a lot going on at the same time. But the fact remains that the currency is collapsing as we see it. And, you know, there are alternatives out there, but how it's going to shake out, what the reset's going to look like, will gold be involved, will be an SDR, who will be the kingpin, will it be the East or the West, all that's unsettled. And I'm of the belief, Dave, that it's not that all bankers are all chummy for this world control. I basically believe that general outlook, but my point is that I'm not so sure that Russia and China, I'm not so sure that the BRICS are all chummy with the Anglo-American Empire. So I think there is an actual friction between them, even though you can build a case that they're just, you know, making a play for, you know, a problem reaction solution. They already know that they're in bed together. I don't believe that. I could be wrong, but I think there is a real friction between the BRICS and the Anglo-Americans, and that they are vying for what is the best new system to take hold for, let's say, the world at large on an economic basis. So a lot's going on. There's a lot to think about.
In 2018, as we move into 2018, where do you think gold and silver are going to go? What do you think is going to happen to the economy? Your opinion, and what do you think is going to happen?
Yeah, I think the economy is not going to crash in 2018. I think the stock market may see some resistance in the first quarter of 2018, but nothing substantially upsetting. I mean, even a 10% move down is 10%. I mean, it's not a crash. It's not a collapse. I think that gold and silver will do okay in 2018 up until probably the third quarter, halfway through the year, maybe a little further than that. And I think at that point, there'll be, and I've said this before and I've been wrong, but I still, you know, that's what I think is what I think, that there'll be a shift. I think there'll be more and more interest in the metals. I think that Bitcoin won't have this, you know, sevenfold increase by that point in time next year. So people starting to look, hey, I bought Bitcoin at 10,000 and it's only, you know, 11,000 now. It's been as high as 15. I didn't get out, that type of thing. So, the metals, I think, are the place to be for the next several years. I think 2018, you can just, you know, buy it and accumulate it. I think the overall economy is going to muddle along and not do a lot. I think there'll be a lot of the same, you know, happy, smiley faces. Everything is wonderful. Everything is contained. Don't worry about anything. We've got it. Well, they don't have a clue what they're doing. And I think, you know, that's it. My outlook is, Yeah, not super gloomy, but I think realistic. It won't be a huge change, I don't think. Unless, of course, and I have to always give this caveat, Dave, and I don't apologize for it. It's something that we all have to bear in mind. Unless there's that black swan. You know?